So next up is Xavier Leroy. He works at Collège de France and Aurillac in Paris. And he is like the father of OCaml. And today he shows us what is like software perfection.
Well, my idea of it, actually.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the invitation to talk here. It's a pleasure. And so I will start actually by a couple of personal anecdotes. Things that happened to me 30 years ago, as I was an undergraduate student, freshly admitted to ENS, Economie Supérieure in Paris, and I was wondering whether to continue doing mathematics or switching to computer science. And so when one of our professors, a mathematician, told us about a one-day workshop he was organizing with others, called something like Mathematics in the Modern World or Mathematics in the Real World, or, well, trying to show that mathematics has practical uses to a general audience. So I went there, and it was kind of interesting. There were some high-level talks, like one by Alain Cohn, a Fields medalist, that went way above my head. But most of the talks were more like industry people telling about mathematical modeling and numerical simulations, which was quite hot in those days. And the star of the day was the chief engineer for the Ariane 4 space rocket. So not Ariane 5, the one that is in use today, and that blew up spectacularly on its first flight. Ariane 4, the older, smaller model that was starting to work very well, and everyone was very proud of it in Europe at that time. And so the guy was telling us all the nice mathematics that went into designing the rocket, aerodynamics, control laws, propulsion, etc., etc. And he mentioned that there's also an onboard computer with 100,000 lines of code that runs everything. And during question time, someone in the audience, probably a computer scientist, asked, but how do you know there's no bugs in your 100,000 lines of code? And the engineer was almost offended and replied crossly, oh, sir, we tested them very carefully. Monsieur, nous les avons testés très soigneusement. And, well, at that time, the answer sounded a little inadequate to me, even today. Okay, I know that in the aerospace industry, they take testing very seriously. That is true. But still, it was disappointing, and it is still disappointing, that so much nice mathematics went into designing the thing, but when it comes to software, it's just testing.
Xavier, it's quite hard to hear you at the back.
Well, I'm sorry, I don't have a microphone, and my voice, well, I can try to shout a little more, but not that much. And second formative experience, a few months later, so I decided to do the computer science, to go the computer science way. And so I went to see another professor, a CS professor. His name was Guy Cousineau. He was one of the original designers of Camel, along with Gérard Wett. And I asked him for a summer internship in systems programming, or perhaps in compilers. And he told me, oh, well, I know a new programming language called Camel that could use some more compilation work. Let me demonstrate. And he showed Camel to me in his big Sun workstation. And I was completely blown. I knew a little bit of Lisp before. He taught me a little bit of Lisp. But here I could see both functional programming and types at the same time. And it looked like something I've never seen. Well, it looked wonderful. And so I guess those two experiences were kind of two starting points, maybe, in what I did next. Research in programming languages and in software reliability. And both this idea that you should be able to gain confidence with software using mathematics and program proof, for instance, and the other idea, which is that programming languages, better programming languages, have an immense role to play. So let me tell you a bit about program proof. As you probably know, even for high assurance software, the verification is mostly code reviews and lots of tests. And of course, there are limitations. So testing is incomplete. You cannot test all the executions of a program, except in a very few cases. As Dijkstra said, it can show the presence, but not the absence of bugs. And it's also very expensive, and you may not realize. But for the highest assurance levels, developing the test suite and validating it against the specs is much more expensive than just developing the software. Okay, so that's where all the cost goes. And of course, as we know, there is an alternative, formal verification, where you use computation and deduction to establish properties that hold of all executions of a program, even in infinite numbers. And properties range from robustness, no crashes, to full correctness with respect to specifications. So this is all well known. What you may not have realized is that this is a very old idea. It's as old as a general purpose programming programmable computer itself. So it appears in a paper, in a communication by Alan Turing himself in 1949. It's a talk that he gave at the inaugural conference on the EDSAC computer, so one of the first computer science conferences also, and the EDSAC was one of the first programmable computers, okay? And so the title is Checking a Large Routine, and he, in two sentences, well, he asks the problem, how one can check a routine, in the sense of making sure that it is right, and he gives a solution, which is to have a number of assertions which can be checked one by one. So kind of local reasoning that will imply the correctness of the whole program. So his large routine is about computing factorial, using only additions. Okay, so you have two listed loops, and in 1949, that was a big program. You have two nested loops, one that iterates addition to do multiplication, and one that iterates multiplication to do factorial. So of course, they didn't have structured programming in those days, so just flowcharts. So this is a flowchart of his program, redrawn from the original. The original is almost unreadable because it was typeset very poorly. And his genius idea was that every program point in this flowchart is associated with a logical invariant. So some kind of relation between the values of the variables that hold in every execution. So that is his notation, which is not very readable. And that's the more modern notation where you have both the flowchart and the assertions superimposed. And to verify the program, it's enough to check that each assertion, like maybe this one, if you start here and you execute that, it will imply the assertion at the successor point. Okay, so lots of small local reasoning that will imply that if you exit here, V is equal to factorial of N. So, and so that's the next 60 years. So first the idea was completely forgotten for about 20 years, then reinvented by Floyd and generalized. So Floyd gives really the rules, still works on flowcharts, but gives the general rules on how to derive those assertions, how to annotate your flowchart with assertions. And also the title of Floyd's paper is interesting, Assigning Meanings to Programs. So he says, well, this is the birth of axiomatic semantics. Okay, he says, okay, the meaning of a program is not just transitions and changing the state of the machine, it's actually the set of logical assertions that it satisfies. It's a very high-level view. And a couple of years later, so Tony Hoare reformulates this for structured programs with those famous triples, so logical assertions of the form is under precondition P, execution of command C gives postcondition Q, and Hoare gives deduction rules for those triples, and correctly observes that this is a logic. It defines a logic to reason about programs, just like we have set theory to reason about mathematics, and model logics to reason about various aspects of discourse. We can also have program logics to reason about programs. And so that was completely completely genius idea. Yet, from the 70s to about 2000s, the general conviction was that this is unusable in practice. Because when you do pencil and paper proofs of programs using Hoare logic, it's extremely painful. Okay, you have lots of small, boring implications to show, and you always get them wrong. So the idea was that it's not usable in practice, and actually a number of researchers found restricted but more automated approaches to verification, such as abstract interpretation or model checking. Okay, so you restrict the properties you can check, but you get a lot more automation. And it's only around 2000 that much progress in automated theorem proving, especially SMT solving, gave rise to practically usable tools for program proof. So mid-2000, that's the rebirth of program proof, and I'm going to demonstrate with one of those tools that appeared at that time. So it's called Pharmacy, and it's open source. It's developed in OCaml at CEA, the Atomic Energy Agency in France. And oops, sorry, I should switch to the demo. And I think it's and so it lets you do program proof for C code. And so here is what it does. So I'm starting with binary search, all right? So pretty much an important basic algorithm, okay? So you probably all know what it does. So you have an array of integers, and you're looking whether a key is in the array or not, and the array is sorted, so you can proceed by binary search, look up in the middle of the array. If it's less or greater, then you move to the first half or the second half of the array, and you iterate. And if I give that to the tool, there's no specification so far. So there's an implicit specification is that it shouldn't crash, all right? And so the tool will look for undefined behaviors. In particular, for instance, will this arithmetic operation overflow because it's undefined behavior, or there's some more arithmetic here, and we also have some memory accesses, so will they be defined or not? And in the absence of more information, it doesn't know. Okay, hence the yellow and red bullets. In particular, if size is a min int, of course, this size minus one will overflow. So I need to give it a little bit of info. And some preconditions about the function. So hypothesis that should be satisfied by the callers. I'm requiring that the size is non-negative, which is reasonable. And that at pointer t, there's a size, an array of size that is valid, okay, that has been properly allocated and not deallocated yet. Okay, just the memory is valid, I can access. And I'm also helping it a little bit by giving some loop invariance. So I expect low, so low high is a search interval, I expect it to be always contained in zero size. And I'm hinting that this quantity, high minus low, the size of the interval decreases. So that will show termination of the loop. Okay, decreases and stays positive. And so now it's a lot happier, but I am not happy with this GUI. Come on. GTK on a Mac is just awful. So for instance, this computation is now green, okay? And however, these loop invariants are still kind of red because, and it cannot say anything about the memory access either, because here there could be an overflow. Indeed, low plus high could overflow. I mean, if your array is big enough, okay, low plus high could be could overflow the maximum integer. And that's actually a common bug in widely used implementations of binary search. So in C, that will cause undefined behavior. In OCaml or Java, that will cause wraparound, so mid will be negative, and your next array access will blow up. So we need to do something. Well, we could restrict the range of size, but it's more fun to actually write a correct formula to compute the midpoint of an interval without overflows, which is low plus half the difference of the width of the interval. And now, Pharmacy will actually verify that this cannot overflow. Come on, please, move away. Oh. Okay, you have to beg. all right, so as you see now, we have a lot more green. All right, so no overflows in this computation of mid. And those array accesses are good, which is not completely obvious either. Okay, so those two array accesses are within bounds. All right, so now we have safe code, code that is not crashing, not invoking undefined behavior, but we still have no idea what it does. Okay, so let's specify a little more. So for instance, I would like to say that if the result is non-negative, then the key is in the array. And actually, the result will be an index where the key is in the array. Okay, so I express this. So it's basically first order logic, okay, with a bit of ASCII art for the syntax. And actually, if I do this, it's extremely easy to prove. And you don't even need hypotheses like the array is sorted or whatever. Okay, it's just that if you hit here, then key is equal to t of mid. So so again, this is easily proved. It is. That green bullet you see here. Okay, so this first condition here is proved. Of course, what is hard is the other part, okay? That is, the result is negative, then the key is nowhere to be found in the array. And for that, of course, So if I do that, just like this, it cannot prove it. And I need to tell it a lot more. So I need to tell it that my array is sorted, which is this requirement here. So you can see the, you can do universal quantification and things like that in your formula. And I need also to enrich my loop invariant, to say basically that to the left of the search interval, all the elements are less than the key, and to the right of the search interval, all the elements are bigger than the key, so that when the search interval is empty, all the elements are different from the key. Okay, that's really the essence of the algorithm that I have to express. Of course, it took several tries to come up with that. But if I do that, actually the whole program can be proved safe and correct with respect to the spec, which I think is pretty good. Okay. And the whole verification time is a couple of seconds. So no, nothing ugly here. So I just want you to see all the green bullets, okay, for the two pass conditions and all the assertions and loop invariant. All right, so end of the demo. Let's see, how am I doing with time? Okay, looks good. Now let me tell you about the second approach that I've also used and practiced with some success, which is to use proof assistance based on typed functional programming to do program proof. So Stephanie already mentioned some of that. I will also give reverence to Curie Howard, because that's such an important moment in the life of computer science. So there's this observation made by Curie, a logician, in 58, and then studied in much more detail by Howard in 69, another logician, which is that simply typed lambda calculus, a programming language, a formalism for computation, is the same thing as a logic, intuitionistic propositional logic, if you squint. So types will look like propositions. Terms, programs of your lambda calculus will look like proofs or constructions, as the intuitionistic people say. And so things that justify that a proposition is true. And moreover, reduction in the lambda calculus, which is steps of execution, will correspond to cut elimination, which is a normalization procedure in logics. It is very important to show consistency of the logic. All right, so that was an interesting observation. Well, Howard was very shy. He said, oh, Curie almost already published it, so I will not submit for publication. I will just send some photocopies to my friends. And those photocopies were extremely influential, because in the 70s and 80s, they inspired a number of unified frameworks for computation and proofs. It's no longer a correspondence between a computational framework and a logical framework. It's a unified framework where you can do both. And the first example is the Martin Luf type theory, of various variants of it, that Presti Patch is the root of for EGDA today, and the calculus of constructions by Kocko and Huet, which you find in Koch and Lee. So they are all based on lambda calculus, plus dependent types, those pi types that Stephanie showed, plus sigma types sometimes, and a stratification in universes that avoid inconsistencies. But originally, I mean, the people who did that, especially Martin Luf, were interested in the foundation of mathematics. Okay, not about program proofs, about having a better alternative to set theory, which it is to a large extent. The realization came a little later that actually we can write programs in such a dependency type lambda calculus, and then we will be able to reason about them without the need of a program logic. Okay, because Your functions, your data structures of your programs are already functions and objects of your logic. Okay, so you don't need a program logic to mediate between the two. And just to try to drive this point home, when you do pharmacy proofs, like I showed, sometimes you use logical functions too. Things that are not written in C, okay, that are typically just axiomatized, like the length of a string would be the index of the first zero byte in the string, okay? And so that's an object of the mathematical world, and you can use it to give a post condition to your string length function, which is executable C code. Okay. And then you still need to do a proof that this C code satisfies this contract. So in a system like Coq, well, of course, the same functions can be used both to describe computations and to state theorems, like the length of a function, which is defined here. It's executable, okay? You can build other computations on top of it, like this combined function that zips two lists but carefully, doing an error if they have different lengths. But you can also use it to state and prove that map is length preserving, okay? It's the same function. And so that's the positive point of using those logical frameworks as programming languages and programming languages and proving systems. The downside, well, there's a requirement which I call hyper-pure functional programming, which is that, well, you can't use imperative features. Okay, but we know how to deal with that. We can use persistent data structures, we can use monads, we can use all the tricks in functional programming books. And all functions must provably terminate, because otherwise the logic, now if you look at your language from a logical viewpoint, your logic is inconsistent. And in this respect, so of course Camel doesn't qualify, okay, or Camel has imperative features, but Haskell doesn't qualify either, because all functions may not terminate. And Stephanie alluded to it at the end of her talk. If you use Haskell, the bottom is a proof for any equality. Any equivalence. So you need to be a little bit careful. And for instance, F star, you may have heard about, which is another functional language with dependent types, is okay because non-termination is a monadic effect in F star. So you can have general recursion, but inside a monad, and that's enough to preserve a hyper-pure core in which you can do logic. All right, but once you learn how to program with terminating functions, then it's bliss. And I'm going to demonstrate that. And in particular, I was able to write this Compsert compiler that Kathleen perhaps mentioned this morning, entirely in this type, okay, and do the proofs at the same time. And so I'll do a demo of a compiler verification project, okay, a very small one. I don't know how many of you have seen are familiar with Coq, but I hope some of you are not, and we'll get a flavor of what it is. All right, so so the exercise is to compile arithmetic expressions to stack machine code and prove the correctness. And so we start by specifying what arithmetic expressions are, okay, with some abstract syntax. So it's just a data type. An expression is either a constant carrying an integer, type Z, a variable, the sum of two expressions, or the difference of two expressions, right? And if I run this through Coq, it's just going, well, it's just type checking, okay, exactly like Haskell or Camel. Now we're going to give it a semantics. Let's call that a denotational semantics, but that's a pretentious name for an evaluation function. Okay, so given an environment, something that maps variable names to values, and an expression E, we will evaluate the expression E by case analysis and recursion, of course. A constant evaluates to itself, a variable evaluates to what it says in the environment, a sum evaluates to the sum of the evaluation, a difference to the difference of the evaluations. So nothing particularly surprising here. And again, yeah, if I run it through Coq, it tells me that it is well typed and that it terminates, because it's structurally decreasing on the second argument E. That was an easy termination proof, but everything will be checked for termination. Now our target language is going to be a stack machine, so in the style of the old Hewlett-Packard pocket calculators. I don't know how many of you have used that. Instead of typing 1 plus 2, you type 1, enter, 2 plus, okay. And there's a stack where intermediate results are stored. So this is the instruction set for our calculator. So we can push a constant on the stack. We can push the value of a variable. We can pop two integers and push their sum. This would be the add operation. And there's a little twist. There are no subtraction, but there's an opposite instruction that pops one integer and push its opposite, minus n. And the code will be just a list of instructions. And again, we need to give a semantics to the machine. So now this will be an, for a change, this will be an operational semantics where we will do transitions between states. So the state of the machine is a piece of code that remains to execute, an environment giving values to variables, and a stack containing intermediate results. Stack is just a list, okay? Excuse me. And now we will have this predicate transition that between two states, the state before and the state after, a transition of the machine. And so there will be four different transitions. So think of that as four inference rules, basically, four axioms for a predicate that depend on the first instruction at the head of the code. So for instance, if your code starts with push const n and followed by c for any environment, any stack, then you will transition to the code C. You will have consumed this instruction. The environment is unchanged, and at the top of the stack, so at the left of the list, you now have n. All right, you've pushed n. Likewise for push var, where you're going to push the value of v as found in the environment. And for an addition, you're going to pop two numbers, n2 and n1, that must be at the top of the stack, so the stack must not be empty for this transition to fire. And you will push back n1 plus n2. Okay, so we've specified one transition of the machine, and now we can specify zero, one, or several transitions as a reflexive transitive closure of that relation. So that's something that is predefined in the Coq standard library. And use that to say what is a successful run of the machine. Okay, so successful run of the machine, it starts with your code, a given environment, empty stack, and it finishes with all the code executed, no code left, the same environment, and a single result at the top of the stack. And that is the result of execution. All right, and now now we need to compile. And so this is the compilation function. So it takes an expression, produces a list of instructions, whose purpose is to evaluate the expression and leave its value at the top of the stack, okay? And the base cases are quite trivial. For instance, if your expression is a constant, you just need to generate one instruction, push constant, that will have exactly the effect I said, okay, to deposit the constant at the top of the stack. Likewise for a variable b, you just push the value of the variable. Where it gets interesting is for compound expressions like sum of u1 and e2. And the idea is recursively you generate some code for e1 that will deposit its value at the top of the stack. Follow it, plus plus is concatenation for list. Follow it by code for e2 that will push the value of e2 on top of the value of e1. Okay. And now you can generate an add instruction that will pop those two intermediate results and combine them correctly. Okay. And so in the end, you will have the sum of e1 and e2 at the top of your stack. And for the difference, it's similar, except that we don't have an instruction to do the difference. And so we simulate it by doing the opposite of the second argument and then an addition. Okay, so we generate those two instructions, sorry, whose effect will be equivalent to a subtraction. And what is cool about those function definitions? So again, they define a mathematical function, but they are also executable. So you can execute within Coq. So for instance, here I'm asking, what is the code for x times x minus 1? Okay, and this is it. And excuse me, I can also extract to executable OCaml, Haskell, or Scheme programs. So this is the OCaml extraction. So there's quite a bit of definitions before, but this is the important thing. So of course, it looks pretty much what you would have written by hand, of course, for such a simple program. All right, so it's all executable, but you can also reason about it. And so what we want to prove is this. Okay, that for any expression, if you give the code, compile x for v, to the machine, and you run the machine, then it runs successfully. It doesn't halt on an empty stack or whatever. It runs successfully, and at the end, you have the value of the expression at the top of your stack. Okay, so the code generated was correct, computes the correct value. And if we try to prove this, So now this is how you do proofs in Coq, and it's not that pretty, but well. So basically, the system tells you, okay, this is the goal. Now tell me at least the first step of the proof. today. And if I scratch my head, actually, I find that, well, of course, I want to do an induction over the expression, but then I will find sub-goals that are not of that form. So it is not going to work. I spare you that. And I need to strengthen the induction hypothesis. So I need to prove a slightly stronger statement that will imply what I want, which is that for any expression, if I execute the code for that expression followed by any code C, in any environment and any stack, I will reach C. So I will consume all the instructions that compute E. The code will be just C, the environment is unchanged, and the value of E will be on top of the stack. And now this is more general, the stack may not be empty, so I will be able to prove that by induction. And this is what I tell Coq. Okay, please do an induction over E, E being an expression, there are four cases. Okay, constants, variable, plus, and diff. And well, I will spare you the details of the proof, but for the first two cases, it's easy because a single instruction can needs to be executed, and that's exactly what I want. Likewise for the variable. And now the interesting cases are the inductive cases, and in particular, the two induction hypotheses that Coq gives me. So I can assume the result for E1 and for E2. And now by combining those things cleverly, or not so cleverly, I can simulate the execution of the code, okay, and prove the different transitions that need to be proved. Okay, I'm going pretty fast because it's not super interesting. And for the difference, it's almost the same, but I also need a bit of arithmetic reasoning. So here, I'm about to compute value of E1 plus the opposite of value of E2, while I want value of E1 minus the value of E2. And so I need to tell Coq that those are equal by one of his tactics, its tactics omega, that does integer reasoning. All right, so then the original Coq test statement is a corollary, okay, just a special case where you instantiate some variables to nil, etc. And the last thing I wanted to mention, so doing those kind of proofs interactively, it's also, well, it helps you discover the problem, okay? But then, in retrospect, you find that maybe several cases look very much the same, or so on. So quite often, a posteriori, you can put some more automation. Okay? Like by telling Coq that, yes, please try to use a constructor for those types. I don't have to tell you, try. It can solve for three of the four goals automatically. And here, I just need to add my little bit of arithmetic reasoning. And again, it is solved automatically. So you can get a little bit of automation, but often a posteriori, after you've discovered the principles of the proof. All right, so that was fast, but I wanted to leave a little bit of time for conclusions and discussions. So, I promised you software perfection in the title of this talk. Well, I'm not quite sure it is within reach, but let's discuss that. I do think that program proof and mechanized logics are huge steps forward in this direction, okay? Because without this kind of backing by mathematics, of programming backed by mathematics, I don't think you can get that far in the road to software perfection. And so do they scale? To some extent. So the pharmacy example I showed more or less scales up to SEL4. Okay, the verified operating system that I think Kathleen mentioned, about a few thousand lines of C code, very hard. And as I said, the compiler demo scales more or less to Concert. So this said, we still have problems, okay? The problem is no longer trusting the program, okay, but it is at the very least trusting your specifications, all right? And that means several things. First, that formal specifications must be available. And that's not always obvious. For some applications, like in embedded systems, there are often control command flows, for instance, that are being implemented, and those have very nice mathematical specifications as differential equations or whatever. Excuse me, I think I need a little water. So yeah, for some applications, there are mathematical specifications that are pretty close. For other applications, we just don't know. I mean, most web services, for instance, most websites have no mathematical specification of any kind. And another example that I like, well, is taken from machine learning, a hot new topic. It's true that many of the tasks for which we use machine learning, especially perception tasks, have no formal specification. Okay, the only spec is the success rate on a set of examples. For instance, image classification, or speech recognition, or I don't know, driverless cars. What is a good speech recognition? Do you have a mathematical formula for that? No, of course. But there are a few problems where machine learning has been used, like this ACAS XU collision avoidance system, which is based on a neural network. But the problem it solves has a perfectly geometric specification in terms of the relative positions of two aircraft and relative speed. Okay, and the goal of the system is to tell the aircraft how to move to avoid collision. For instance, one is going up and the other down, but you don't want both to go up. Okay. So, and that is a geometric problem, a physics problem that has a nice mathematical specification. And you can do formal verification of the neural network. That's what Gary Katz and his colleagues did. So, as you see, AI is not the antithesis of formal methods. Okay, the lack of specification is. Then your formal specification should be as clear and simple as possible. And there's a disturbing trend I see in Koch users, and maybe even a little bit in Stephanie's talk, which is to complicate your spec to have simpler proofs. And no, you shouldn't do that. A bigger proof is warranted if it keeps your spec simple. And then when the formal specifications will have to be reviewed and perhaps even tested to build confidence. So executable specs are a plus. A few other limitations. So hardware is not as perfect as we software people like to think. For instance, two industrial users of OCaml independently found a bug in the Skylake Intel processors. Okay. And there's all these attacks, Warhammer, Meltdown, Spectre, etc., where you can cause the hardware to malfunction or leak secrets in ways that formal specification of a piece of software will not anticipate. Specification languages are in their infancy, I would say. First order logic is like the Fortran of specification languages. Okay, it works, but there might be nicer languages. And just like we like specific domain-specific languages, why not domain-specific specification languages? And finally, I think we teach logic badly in math and computer science curricula. I still see students entering a master's curriculum in CS, and they don't know the difference between for all and there exists. And I mean, it's tough to write a spec when you don't have any mastery of logic, right? So I think something can be done. Okay, so that's the end, my final message. Try and prove your programs. They will thank you. The B method is interesting because it is a method and it comes with tools and it comes with training material and I mean it's a complete solution that you can give to industrial users, and some of them have done very nice things using the B method, like verifying driverless metro systems in Paris. So that's a positive thing. The negative thing is that yes, it is a much more restricted formalism. Okay, you need to cast your problem in terms of transition systems, basically, which works for a lot of problems. I don't think I could do my compiler. I don't think I could prove concert using the B method, for instance. Okay, it's just a little too specialized. But again, that might be an example of what I dream of, those domain-specific specification languages, the B virtual machines and the refinement principles. That's an example of a domain-specific specification formalism. More questions? Yeah, Manuel?
I agree with this last statement that do you have any suggestions for improving that situation?
Which situation?
I agree with your statement that logic is being taught badly.
The teaching of logic, yeah. I don't know. So I'm part of the generation that was force-fed set theory from the youngest age. The age of 6 or 7, we were drawing Venn diagrams and with intersections and unions and the set of kids with a yellow sweater, blah, blah, blah. And in retrospect, I wonder what would happen if we were just to teach basic logic in the same way, okay? Just as a game, okay? All kids with a yellow sweater have are boys, so what can you say, et cetera, et cetera. Maybe I'm just idealistic, but it's true that often logic is taught late and poorly, I would say.
Do you think that there could be a visual language for proving? For example, how you debug the code, you go step by step mm-hmm. over the code, see some context, and debug what happens.
So there might be a little bit of that. Well, the pharmacy demo was already somewhat visual in the sense that it shows you what is okay and what remains to be done, in a way. I think there are systems, but more in the model checking community, that are really based on symbolic execution of the code. So where basically you can at least mentally follow the flow of executions and then derive assertions corresponding to the current point. So there may be something to be done like that, yeah.
So once we achieve software perfection and we start proving everything, will languages like a camel become obsolete? What's the role for them?
Perhaps a camel will just be, you know, the back end for Coq, just like JavaScript is the back end for. And I think I would be happy about that. I mean, my task would be done. So yes, it is true that to some extent, the perfect software is software that disappears. Okay, but there are still some aspects that are beyond specs, maybe like algorithmic efficiency. Okay, so often the specs just talk about functional correctness. Algorithmic efficiency is often on top of that. Even though some people, like François Potier in my group, are also working on how to specify algorithmic complexity as part of our triples, basically. So yeah, I think there is still room for good programming, even for perfect software, like to have efficient algorithms, to use resources cleverly. But at least there won't be any need for debugging your functional behaviors. And that is good. Yes?
There's some tension, I believe, between compositionality and
uh-huh.
verification.
Uh-huh.
In that if you have some upfront goal you want to verify, theorem, and now you have this big monolithic proof for your big monolithic program, but on the other hand, if you try to verify each component and then put it together, and the components maybe predate the thing you're making, maybe you will not have enough information in
mm-hmm.
Lemmas to come up with your overall theorem. Do you have any ideas on how this tension may resolve?
I think it is a challenge, but it is also a strength of those deductive approaches, which is that you don't need the whole program, okay? You can start function by function and give a contract to each function and move your way up progressively. And have reusable verifications, like when some people are using pharmacy to prove a C standard library, for instance. That would be really cool because everyone can benefit. Or crypto libraries also. And this is in contrast, for instance, to model checking based approaches, which are often whole program and kind of brittle for that reason. But you're right that then if you want to reuse some code or have black boxes and so on, you need all specifications also for those components. Yeah. In the back, yeah.
So when we do some small software, we usually rely on mathematical properties of natural numbers and real numbers. And of course, when we extract a program,
mm-hmm.
it doesn't remove mathematical properties of numbers because machine integers.
Yep. So. Well, there are two ways. So the reason you can reason about your machine numbers, okay, like we did in the pharmacy demo, all those problems with integer arithmetic overflow, for instance, that's because these are machine integers. So for clock, you can also not use machine integers. So yeah, probably I don't have time to go back to the extracted code, but you can very well extract code that will use PNO integers or Koch's notion of integers, which are built from first principles and never overflow, may run out of memory, but never overflow, and are quite slow, but never mind. So for instance, Concert runs without any machine integer arithmetic and floating point arithmetic. It all uses Koch's verified and slow arithmetic. So it's a trade-off. Yeah. John, you had a question, if we have that.
Last question.
Oh, yes.
I want to come back to the aerospace software that you started off talking about. You talked about the cost of testing aerospace code, and that's partly because of the need for MCDC coverage, although there are tools that can help with that, but it's also partly because of the need for traceability between the test cases and the requirements, isn't it?
That is true. If you replace
the testing by Koch specification, there'll still be a need for traceability back to the less formal requirements.
That is true.
It's not obvious that that will be very much cheaper. I wonder if you have you looked at this problem?
Not in great details. I know some people at Airbus, for instance, who've been giving a lot of thoughts to that. So it's true that the current mandatory practices to develop aerospace software are heavily biased toward testing anyway. So we don't know very well how formal methods fit in there. But yes, so clearly that gets into my formal specifications must be reviewed and tested part. My hope is that the formal specification can be much, much smaller and clearer and crisper than the actual code. Okay, so there will already be benefits. My fear is that the people who do the reviews, at least initially, are more familiar with code than with logic. So they will find it harder. So again, we also come back to the point of better training in logic. It's also for the reviewers.
Great, thank you very much.